We have breaking news, some tragic news at 8 a.m. A 29-year-old woman from New South Wales has been killed in a golf buggy accident on Hamilton Island. We understand that the driver had been attempting a U-turn when the buggy rolled. The driver was not physically injured in the incident. Investigations are underway. So Hamilton Island, we know that if you've ever travelled there, that's the way of getting around over there. But that is very sad news. And we'll have more on that as soon as we possibly can. Also under investigation today, the culture at Collingwood is being questioned after another scandal emerges. Two of the club's youngest players caught out using social media to rate women.
She's a 9.5, but he's homeless.
This comes as Jordan Ngoi's playing future remains uncertain this morning. Today, Melbourne reporter Christine Ahern is outside the club's headquarters. Chris, any sign of the players this morning?
Carl, just moments ago, one of those players, Jack Ginnivan, arrived here at Magpie headquarters. He was asked whether he thought it was appropriate to rate women online and if he regretted anything. He didn't say a thing. However, skipper Scott Pendlebury said that the club would be releasing a statement later today. So that has happened just moments ago. Of course, it was Jack Ginnivan and also another young gun, Isaac Quaynor, who were in this TikTok video as part of an apparent viral game, rating women out of 10. According to their appearance. This, of course, is the last thing that Collingwood needs. They're already in damage control, dealing with the fallout from Jordan Ngoi's wild trip to Bali. No punishment on that has yet been dished out. We do understand that the club met with the 26-year-old yesterday. However, there are reports that the Magpies have taken off the table a very lucrative contract, reportedly worth $800,000 a year for 2 years, with a trigger for another 2 years. So all that has to be played out here at Collingwood today, whether they are going to still offer Jordan Ngoi a new contract, whether he has indeed lowered his price because of his bad behaviour. But now, what, if any, punishment they're going to hand out to these two young guns caught out in this TikTok video. Carl.
Christine Ahern, thank you.
An investigation has been launched into whether energy companies are ripping off Australians as the country struggles with a power crisis. Let's bring in federal politics reporter Fiona Whelan, who's in Canberra. Fee, the Treasurer has asked the consumer watchdog to investigate.
Ali, the ACCC has the power to force companies to open their books. So it'll be looking at the profit margins to see if there are any signs of price gouging during the crisis. The Treasurer called on the ACCC to launch this inquiry after a huge spike in electricity prices. He also wants it to investigate whether companies were gaming the market when they withdrew electricity supply last week, of course sparking blackout warnings. Many claim they did that because the high cost of coal and gas made it impossible to operate profitably. His government minister, Bill Shorten.
Energy companies should not be making undue profits when everyone else are doing it hard with cost of living and a winter snap.
The consumer watchdog will report its findings to federal and state energy ministers next month. Ali?
Thanks, Fee.
Home Affairs Minister Claire O'Neill has met with the Sri Lankan Prime Minister in Colombo. He has assured Australia that his administration is committed to fighting an apparent asylum seeker boat surge. The Albanese government has pledged $50 million in aid to the country in the depths of an economic crisis. It's prompted the PM to reiterate his stance on people smugglers.
People who arrive by boat will not be settled here. Very clearly, our system is in place of Operation Sovereign Borders. People smugglers seek to trade in misery.
At least three boats from Sri Lanka have been intercepted in the past month. Australian athletes have spoken up after a controversial decision by the international swimming body to ban trans women from competing. Today, Queensland reporter Mia Glover is on the Gold Coast. Mia, good morning to you. There are mixed opinions on this move.
Yeah, there has been. Alex, good morning again to you. Lots of mixed reaction over the last 24 hours, hasn't there been? But some Aussie athletes have come out absolutely swinging, slamming this decision by FINA, which has seen all transgender athletes banned from competing in women's swimming categories. One of them spoke to us a little earlier on the show. That is Ricky Coughlin. She is arguably one of the country's first women who underwent that transition.
I think the ruling, it it's fails in leadership, and it's lazy on science and ethics. This means that we're still not thinking this through properly.
A lot of attention will now be put towards other sporting codes. What will they be doing in light of this decision? No doubt lots of tough decisions will have to be made over the next couple of months. Alex?
Mia, thank you. Greens leader Adam Bandt has pulled a controversial move, bluntly refusing to speak next to the Australian flag at a Sydney press conference. The flag was picked up and moved to the side by a staffer, leaving the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander flags behind him. He says the Australian flag represents lingering pain, pushing for a new flag and a republic.
A protest is underway at New South Wales Parliament right now as the state stares down its largest ever debt in today's budget. Gabriel Boyle is amongst the revelry there. Gabby, good morning to you. Unions have a message for the government today.
They certainly do, Carl. I'm joining you from Hospital Road, which is at the back of the New South Wales State Parliament. There's about 100 protesters that have lined the street here with a very clear message for the politicians as they enter through the back gate of State Parliament to start their day at work. Of course, it is a very important day here at State Parliament. Journalists, political journalists from across the state have just gone into the four-hour budget lock-up where we'll get a really clear perspective on how our money will be spent over the next 12 months. But these union representatives want their voices heard. They know it's probably a little bit too late for this budget, but they still have a point that they want to get across. You're worried about wage increase levels, aren't you?
We certainly are. Our members deserve more than 3%, and this government needs to take a very clear look at what our members have gone through under COVID and kept the state operating.
There's some very frustrated people here this morning.
Yes, and child protection workers and frontline workers deserve more. 3% won't pay the rent.
You're really worried about the money that you're being offered, aren't you?
Yeah, so look, it's never too late for this government to show respect to the workers that have kept the state running through floods, through fires and through the pandemic. And they really need to look at their own selves and the fact that they've given themselves pay rises, and then they're throwing out that out to a really small amount out to those that have really kept the state running.
Thanks for your time this morning. Carl, we're expecting the protesters to remain here for the next couple of hours, but of course later on this afternoon we'll get a bit of perspective on exactly what that budget holds for the New South Wales voting public, and they'll be paying very close attention because let's not forget there is a state election looming.
Gabby, thank you. Meantime, Queensland's Treasurer is promising to deliver record health spending when he hands down his state's budget today. Cameron Dick says hospitals will get a much-needed cash injection as the system looks to recover post-pandemic. $3.5 billion will be pumped into rail projects, promising to create more jobs right across the Sunshine State. Meantime, mining companies are tipped to be the losers with a hike in royalties after a 10-year freeze.
An 18-year-old skier who tragically died after slamming into a tree at Thredbo has been named. Oliver Johnston was a former student at Shaw School in North Sydney. He lost control on the slopes, veering off the path on Sunday morning. He was treated at the scene, but later died.